if peak oil happens and people don't understand what's going on, it could very easily be a global tipping point. It is basically every bit as serious as thermonuclear war. We thought that was really serious. Now, you could argue that was silly. We spent 50 years worrying about that and we never had one. I would argue maybe one of the reasons we never had one is that we worried about it for 50 years.
It's going to be a dramatic, catalytic event for the human family.
We're heading for the cliff at 80 miles an hour, and the brakes are out.
The four horsemen of the apocalypse: war, famine, pestilence, and death.
It will be painful, and it will be very disruptive, and it will revolutionize the way that we live.
In a period of hundreds of millions of years, with enormous pressure and heat, the Earth formed petroleum from decayed living matter. And in less than 150 years, by many estimates, we have bled the planet of roughly half of its oil. We have extracted roughly 1 trillion barrels of oil since the late 19th century. Most of that oil has been consumed by Western societies, and it has been, arguably, the basis for the enormous power and wealth of Western nations. Now, most of the remaining oil on Earth lies underground in less industrially developed countries. In order to get that oil, and to get it as cheaply as possible, Western companies have devastated environments and caused terrible human suffering. People in Western societies are largely unaware of the harm caused from oil extraction. We are unaware because it goes unreported. Now we are confronted by the prospect of world peak oil. Peak oil is the point in time where the quantity of petroleum extracted from the Earth begins to irreversibly decline. As fossil fuels are so deeply intertwined in our existence, particularly our food production, the results could be catastrophic, especially in the face of rapidly rising oil demand. And as oil becomes scarce and prices rise, the environmental destruction and human suffering will likely increase. And the competition for oil will get more aggressive.
One of the most common questions that people ask is, do you think that the peak oil that you write about is going to produce a global catastrophe? And my answer is, it already has. There are people dying right now as we're speaking. There are people dying right now over oil. There are governments being twisted and changed and seized over oil. The climate is changing because of oil. And there's a small group of very, very wealthy people who are getting richer and richer because of oil.
Energy derived from fossil fuels has been the source of the incredible growth of the human population. It may be the single greatest impact fossil fuels have had on the planet.
You can trace human evolutionary success in terms of the rates at which we've been able to appropriate energy from our environment. There's virtually no human population growth for, let us say, 50,000 years prior to agriculture. But with agriculture, we began to modify entire landscapes, replacing other species with food crops that we wanted for ourselves. And the human species spread over the planet in greater and greater numbers.
Then something happened a couple of hundred years ago, actually a little bit more. We started using coal to burn, to release energy.
And therefore we were able to cut down the forests, which had been a fuel source before, and replace them with fields where we could grow food. We increased the food, we increased the number of people. By 1800, we hit our first 1 billion people. So all of human history, all several hundred thousand years of modern human history, to produce that 1 billion people in 1800. Now we're starting to get really efficient at the use of ancient sunlight. In fact, we found a more transportable form of it, oil. In 1867, Colonel Drake drilled the first successful oil well in Titusville, Pennsylvania. The second billion people took only 130 years, 1930. The third billion took only 30 years, 1960. The fourth billion took only 14 years, 1974. The fifth billion, 1987. And the sixth billion, 1999. So we've seen this explosion of population. And it's been fueled by the availability of fossil fuels.
As population rose, so did consumption levels, driven mostly by Western industrialized nations. Our dependence on petroleum grew to roughly 1.3 trillion gallons per year, along with our dependence on an equal amount of energy from a combination of coal and natural gas. That amount of oil, stacked in 5-gallon containers, would reach to the moon over 250 times in a single year.
I calculated that in a single person's life in this country, you will be confronted at one time or another in your life to about 30,000 different items that have a very intimate connection with fossil fuels. We don't have time to enumerate the 30,000 items, okay? But they are there, from the light fixtures, paint in your house, to the pesticides, insecticides, the fibers, the fabrics, heart valves, composite material, aircrafts of the future, vehicles of the future, the list goes endlessly.
Fossil fuels provide energy for production and transportation of virtually every product we own or consume. And many of those products are actually made from petroleum. To get an idea of how deeply embedded fossil fuels are in our everyday products, let's take the example of a nylon shirt. Nylon itself is made from crude oil. An enormous amount of energy is used throughout the process of creating the shirt, almost all of it fossil fuel energy. First, the crude oil is extracted from the ground. Then it is shipped to a refinery where it is distilled into chemicals that make nylon. The polymers are shipped to a factory to create the nylon thread. The thread is then shipped overseas where, using machinery and labor, the shirt is made. Then it is shipped back to North America and trucked to a store. The consumer drives a car to the store, buys the shirt, and drives back home. The shirt is not only made of oil, it's awash in oil. A similar trail of energy use can be followed for nearly every product we consume. But nowhere are fossil fuels more critical to humanity than in the production of food.
Every organism has to get more energy from its food than it expends in getting its food. Like coyote, if it has to spend more energy in running down the rabbit than it can get from eating the rabbit, that's not a good situation. And if this happens habitually over time, the coyote dies. We human beings have been able to get around that constraint through the use of fossil fuels. We use natural gas as a feedstock for chemical fertilizers. We use oil to make chemical pesticides and herbicides. And then we transport foods ever further distances. We're using far more energy than we'll ever get from eating the food. For every calorie of food energy we get, we've invested something like 10 calories of energy in growing the food, transporting it, cooking it, and so on. For any other organism, this would spell extinction.
One of the foundational myths of our culture is based on a truth and a lie. The truth is that if you're naked and hungry and outdoors and it's cold and raining, you're unhappy. I think we can all agree on that. And if somebody brings you in and gives you clothing and sets you next to a fire and gives you a big bowl of soup, you go from being unhappy to happy real quickly. Basic needs are met. So that's the truth. The lie is that, well, if that amount of stuff will make you that happy, then twice as much stuff will make you twice as happy. 10 times as much stuff will make you 10 times as happy. 100 times as much stuff will make you 100. 1,000 times as much. 1,000,000 times as much. And Bill Gates lives in a state of perpetual bliss. That's the lie. It's one of the things that is driving us to destroy this earth and ourselves.
Well, there's actually been polling over many decades and happiness levels of various populations. If you look at the polls today as opposed to the polls in the 1950s, Americans are just about as happy on average as they were 50 years ago. And yet consumption levels have tripled during that period.
Now, that being the case, how is it that we've compelled ourselves into this world in which material growth becomes the primary focus of almost all of our endeavors? And what we find is that, in many respects, the power of this myth, again, overrides all the data that suggests we've far exceeded the level of consumption required for a sense of personal well-being. There are volumes of letters written by people who were on the Titanic who survived, but they recall having argued with other passengers to get in the lifeboats, get in the lifeboats. And there are a couple of accounts of people holding up the brochure of the Star Line saying, why should I get in the lifeboat? It says right here that this is an unsinkable ship. And that again is the power of myth. These people would obviously rather believe in the power of the myth than in the necessity to change their way of being and get in the lifeboat. Well, look, we're all looking for lifeboats now, and we should be encouraging each other to get in those lifeboats. Abandon the myth. If we keep behaving this way, the ship will go down.
The American way of life, to put it bluntly, is not sustainable. This quote of George I in Rio de Janeiro at the Earth Summit in 1992 was that the American way of life was not open for negotiation at that summit. And at the same time, he was very prominently sort of speeding around in his speedboat off of Maine, and that sort of epitomizing the American way of life. I think that that does really represent a big challenge in terms of the U.S. relationship to the rest of the world. The very heavy, you know, disproportionate use of resources in the U.S. is very well known and understood throughout the world, and it's one of the things that the U.S. is resented for.
When I hear our leaders tell us that the American way of life is non-negotiable, the first response that comes to my mind is, well, yeah, maybe, but you know, beyond a certain point, nature doesn't negotiate. We may want to maintain the American way of life indefinitely into the future, but the fact of the matter is, it's just not in the cards. The world does not have the resource base to enable us to maintain this way of life. And ultimately, that's a good thing. I mean, if you could imagine the rest of the world attempting to live as we are indefinitely, the consequence would be the destruction of the biosphere.
We roughly consume twice as much of almost everything as the Europeans do. The Europeans, of course, have a standard of living that is very, very close to ours. So that's a very striking difference. Not only do we use the most in the world, we use 25% of the world's oil with 4.5% of the world's population, but we're actually expanding our use of oil on a year-on-year basis. So the current reality is that the U.S. is profligate, wasting oil, setting a bad example.
The Bush administration is in a trap. They're in a trap because they've made a commitment to preserve the existing energy paradigm in this country, the existing industrial paradigm of big oil, big automobiles, big highways, and all that goes with it. And the only way to preserve that paradigm is to gobble up more and more of the rest of the world's oil. There is no other way to do it. The only way to get out of this is to reduce our dependency on petroleum, period. We have to consume a lot less oil in our day-to-day lives. There is no other way to break out of this trap.
Consumption of almost everything is going up dramatically and has the potential to rise to many times the current level because of the fact that you've got large parts of the world population, China, India, Africa, etc., that are really just entering the stage where they have people that are having, you know, amenities like transportation, heating, air conditioning, and all the rest of it.
The Chinese want to have every one of them, once they make this transition from the agrarian, poor, $1,000 a year existence, they want to buy a private car. Consider this. There is 1.7 people per car in the United States. There are 117 people per car in China.
If every Chinese were to consume the way Americans do, you know, we would need six planet Earths to support the global economy. China is certainly becoming a big consumer of almost everything, and that's not too surprising given that China has 1.3 billion people and it's had an economy that's been growing at 8 to 10% a year, really consistently for the last, you know, at least 15 years. We've seen that most obviously in the oil market, but Chinese demand has driven up everything from oil prices to steel prices, cement prices, wood prices, almost everything over the last couple of years.
A sizable chunk of China's industrial generated surplus will have to be spent to acquire energy, which then in turn will help them further improve their industrialization, and it will create further energy demand, and it becomes this vicious cycle. They are absolutely terrified about this cycle of increasing demand, further increase in industrialization, and increase in demand over and over again. It cascades from there on. China has gone berserk in its energy demand. There has never been a country in the history of the energy business has increased its energy demand by 20% in 1 year, and China did it in 2005.
China's increasing its oil imports at a dramatic rate. China has now become the world's second foremost oil importing nation after the U.S.
The United States will not be the reality of the world economy over the next 13, 15 years from now. China is going to be the reality in the world energy situation and in the world economy, in fact. They already have a $600 billion surplus, trade surplus this year. They don't care about the oil price. They are going to go out there and get the energy. We are, as we speak, in a horrendous geopolitical contest with the Chinese for the same energy sources. They are everywhere in the world, and they are far more aggressive than the United States. The trillion-dollar question is, in fact, is there enough energy to supply the Chinese needs?
Oil is the most important source of energy in the world today. It provides about 40% of the world's energy supply, far more than any other source. Control over the flow of oil translates into immense political power and political influence. And it has been the policy of the United States since World War II that it be the United States and no other country that controls this vital source of world power.
The stakes are high. Iraq is already a rich and powerful country that possesses the world's second largest reserves of oil and over 1 million men under arms. Our country now imports nearly half the oil it consumes and could face a major threat to its economic independence. Much of the world is even more dependent upon imported oil and is even more vulnerable to Iraqi threats.
I don't think anybody except think tank types and ideologues believe that we're in the Middle East for democracy. The U.S. relationship with Saudi Arabia, which is our most important relationship in the Middle East, goes from the White House to a royal palace, which is inhabited by monarchs of the 14th century variety, like the kings that we fought a war against in 1776.
The Shah of Iran was our ally. Saddam Hussein was our ally. The government of Pakistan today is our ally. The government of Saudi Arabia today is our ally. These are all countries that have very poor human rights records and that are essentially run by different forms of authoritarian rule. They have existed largely in a deal, particularly the Saudis, that they would become our partner in the stabilization of the oil world in return for us guaranteeing their security, both externally but also as a government.
Let me be clear, the sovereign independence of Saudi Arabia is of vital interest to the United States.
Look at this from the perspective of Saudi Arabians. They see Americans protecting the royal family against resistance. The Saudi Arabian National Guard, whose function is to protect the royal family and silence dissent, always has been armed by the United States. As far as they're concerned, we're totally complicit with the repression, the lack of freedom, the lack of democracy in their country. We are part and parcel of the Saudi dictatorship. I think almost every American, when you push them on that, will nod that that's exactly the case, so that we're not there for democracy.
I think the Iraq War was about oil, absolutely. One of the members of the British cabinet said at one point, "Do you think we would invade if they exported carrots?"
I believe most Americans understand that our dependence on petroleum is a source of vulnerability for this country. It invites attack, it invites terrorism, it's a threat to our well-being.
To meet our growing demand for gasoline, America now imports about 1 million barrels of refined gasoline every day.
He understands he has to offer Americans some sign, some evidence that he's aware of this concern and is doing something about it. Well, the thing that he has offered is drilling in Anwar.
To make America less dependent, Congress needs to pass a pro-growth, pro-jobs, pro-environment development of Anwar. It makes sense.
Well, it's an outright lie. Using the Department of Energy statistics, we have to import so much more oil each year, and Anwar has so little that each year, despite Anwar, we'll still be increasing our dependence on foreign oil.
Our long-term outlook has an increase in oil demand in this country over the next 20 years of about 8 million barrels a day. Almost all of that oil will have to be imported.
We use more than 20 million barrels of oil a day in the United States. By 2025, we will increase our daily consumption by 8 million barrels, according to the Department of Energy. 90% of that increase will need to be imported, despite drilling in the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge.
If you look at the Department of Energy's figures on where that oil is going to come from, more and more of it is going to come from unstable, divided, fractious, terrorist-ridden areas of the world. The Persian Gulf, West Africa and North Africa, the Andean region of Latin America, and Central Asia. The more we go into those areas, the more resistance we're going to face and the more risk that American troops will have to be sent over there to protect the flow of oil, to protect the refineries, the pipelines, and the sea routes that carry the oil. And that's exactly what's happening under the Bush administration. We are turning the military into a global military protection service, and more of our troops are in very risky places, putting their life on the line to protect the flow of oil to fill up American cars. And inevitably, there will be a loss of life. And the more dependent we become on this foreign oil, the greater the price in blood that we're going to have to pay to keep maintaining our existing oil dependency.
In pursuit of extracting oil as cheaply as possible for consumption largely by Western nations, oil development has devastated environments in many locations around the globe. Ecuador is one example. In 1964, Texaco began drilling for oil in the northern region of the Ecuadorian Amazon. During the period from 1964 to 1992, Texaco extracted more than 1 billion gallons of oil from what was, prior to the oil exploration, a pristine rainforest.
Texaco's going into Ecuador is a classic example of a giant, powerful oil company entering an environment in a country where the government had no idea how to regulate and what to do. When Texaco entered Ecuador in the mid-1960s, Ecuador had never drilled for oil. Texaco was the first company to come in and develop oil drilling infrastructure. Their executives made what turned out to be a very fateful decision. They decided to use practices that they were not using in the United States that were substandard compared to what was being used industry-wide at that time around the world. One is they decided to dump toxic water of formation directly into the rainforest environment instead of reinjecting it thousands of feet underground like they were doing at that point in other countries. When crude oil is taken out of the ground, it has two parts. One is the marketable crude that goes to the refinery and onto the commercial market. The other is waste product. It's toxic water that contains 2% crude and some of the most harmful carcinogens known to man. Of the 18 billion gallons of toxic wastewater dumped, if you just take the 2% of toxic wastewater that's pure crude, you have an amount of crude dumped that's 30 times larger than the Exxon Valdez spill. If you also include the other 98% of the wastewater, which contains carcinogens, you have an oil disaster the likes of which this world has never seen before. And what's so disturbing about what happened in Ecuador is that this was done deliberately to save money.
El pueblo de Achuara está muy preocupado por todos esos daños causados por la Texaco y por otras empresas petroleras. Porque esos daños que han causado es un daño irreparable. Y no tiene cómo volver a dejar como antes. Con todos esos daños han quedado para los pueblos indígenas.
You know, you can see literally hundreds of open air toxic waste pits filled with like this oil sludge that dot the landscape, and these leach into the groundwater. And the groundwater is the source of drinking water for the region. Thank you. There are thousands of people right now who, because of what Texaco did in Ecuador, are living in a cancer zone where every day they are forced to drink contaminated water just to survive. Thousands of people are being exposed daily to carcinogens. Thousands of people are at risk of contracting cancer. Many of them already have cancer, many of them have passed away. And if this is not cleaned up soon, I believe, as do many medical observers, that in the next decade, we will see countless numbers of innocent people perish, including children.
Oil extraction has not only caused environmental damage, it has generated increased poverty in already impoverished nations. And it has triggered human rights abuse. Ruthless dictatorships are sometimes a partner in the extraction of oil. Nigeria is but one example.
Those countries that have oil or other forms of minerals actually do worse in their development than those countries that don't have oil and don't have minerals. They have higher rates of malnutrition than many of the non-oil countries. They often have very surprising rates of infant mortality. They often have extreme levels of poverty. So a country like Nigeria, which has been living off of oil since the 1960s, has an overwhelming percent of its population living on less than a dollar a day.
Within the period Nigeria was producing more oil, statistics show you that about 70% of the people, even today, live below the poverty line. 70% of the people. And we're talking of a population of over 100 million. So poverty level has actually increased with years of oil production instead of going down.
You visually look at the Niger Delta and you see the fishing areas have been destroyed, the land has been destroyed, there's oil seepage everywhere, there's pollution everywhere, you can't drink the water. The ways people used to live have changed. And it's a very dramatic, visually dramatic result that you can see after 30 years of oil exploration, or even more actually, in that area.
In response to the human suffering resulting from the pollution in the Niger Delta, Ken Sarawiwa, a local poet, writer, and businessman, organized the Ogoni people living in the Niger Delta region to seek justice from the oil companies and the government that allowed the environmental devastation to take place.
The Ogoni are fishing and farming people. They have lived in a very fertile area that produced most of the food that was eaten in the Delta proper. Shell found oil in the Ogoni area in 1958. Since then, they found about 6 oil fields in an area that has the highest population density in Africa, which is about 1,500 people per square mile.
Ken was extremely effective in organizing against Shell's activities in Ogoni land. He founded the Movement for the Survival of the Ogoni People, MOSOP. And MOSOP really was a very effective organizing group at a time when this was pretty much unheard of in the Niger Delta region. This made Shell, which was the dominant oil producer in the Niger Delta, very upset. As far as we know, Shell started lobbying the Nigerian government to do something about this activist group that was beginning to really put pressure on the oil companies to do things differently and draw attention, even internationally, to the environmental damage.
I do not want any blood spilt, not of an Ogoni man, not of any strangers amongst us. We are going to demand our rights peacefully, non-violently, and we shall win. Yeah.
A memorandum was written in May of 1994, apparently sent from the internal security forces in the Ogoni region to the Nigerian military. The memo stated, "Shell operations still impossible unless ruthless military operations are undertaken for smooth economic activities to commence." MOSOP's efforts to protect the environment and human rights were evidently an obstacle to Shell's oil extraction operations in Ogoni land. In the ensuing months after this memo was written, several Ogoni villages were attacked, killing villagers and destroying homes.
I think it was a military punishment for the Ogoni people to teach them a lesson, I presume.
Ken and several others were arrested and then tried in what I think is internationally recognized to have been a kangaroo court.
Together with a number of other minority rights activists, he was executed by the military regime. Shell Corporation was there during the trial. People protested all over the world, begging Shell to stop the execution.
I think that if she had really made more effort to intervene on behalf of Ken Saro, he would have still been alive today. Ogoni Day in 1993 was the most exhilarating experience for me. It was wonderful to see a people who had been docile for so long. It was good to see fear no longer a part of them. And on that day, when I saw the large number of people streaming into Bori from their various villages, I really felt a sense of fulfillment. If I had died the day after that, I would have died a very happy man indeed.
People in this country depend on oil. We should understand where it comes from and the price that's paid.
I truly believe that a lot of the things that go on in the third world that American companies do or the American government does would not happen if the American people were properly informed by the media of the overall consequences of these policies. The media is the link that allows people to be informed, to make intelligent decisions about how to live their lives. And when you lack that information, it's very hard to take action.
TV has gone from being TV to crack TV, or to free-based TV. You know, it's so much more intense with news going, you know, and the things along the bottom, you know, and all. It's like just, you know, it's super intense, right?
They were on a voyage.
Family safety and security.
The blockbuster legal chart. And can your cat do this?
Back in the 80s, it was required that if you were going to use the public airwaves, you had to perform public service. And one of the ways that television networks and television stations satisfied this public service requirement in order to keep their licenses was by producing television news. Now TV news is another profit center, just like TV entertainment and TV sitcoms and everything else. And so we no longer have news on TV in the United States. We have infotainment.
More on the McDonald's makeover is Ronald McDonald himself.
Hey, how you doing? Hello, Amy.
This new approach to better health, what do you make of all that?
Well, I think the clothes are terrific. You've got to see them. I got a great new Go Active warm-up suit.
What about your buddies, Grimace and the Hamburglar? Are they getting into shape too? Grimace looks like he could lose a few pounds.
Well, you know what? Actually, for a Grimace, he's in really good shape.
And it's not about what's really happening in the world or what's really important in the world or even what's really going to affect you and me ultimately in the world. It's about what's going to get the most ratings. So we're treated to runaway brides and Michael Jackson and O.J. Simpson and all these things that have no impact whatsoever on our lives.
I think most important, we need a media that tells the truth. We need a media that is not in bed with corporations, that gets out there and sheds a spotlight where it matters. Because there is no glare of a media spotlight, the corporations get away with what they can. And that's very frightening because the people of these communities pay a very high price. Sometimes they pay with their lives.
It's all related to fossil fuel consumption, there's no question. And so when you asked me about, was it population and consumption that's driving a lot of environmental change and degradation, the consumption of fossil fuels is by far the largest driver of all environmental degradation that we see.
Climate change is caused primarily by the carbon dioxide that's building up as a result of fossil fuel combustion. The evidence of it, from shrinking ice caps to the fact that a whole variety of ecosystems are now changing in response to dramatically higher temperatures.
heat is a form of energy. And as the heat in the atmosphere increases, the energy in the atmosphere increases. That increased energy in the atmosphere causes more severe storms, more violent hurricanes, more violent tornadoes, bigger hailstorms, bigger thunderstorms.
Almost certainly there's going to be severe damage to human societies, sea level rise, increased frequency of droughts, probably more severe weather conditions, probably spread of a number of diseases into areas where they weren't prevalent before.
Our carbon dioxide levels are spiking again. And this represents a significant threat to the human race in that it will produce changes in climate that will upset the equilibrium. For example, you have the North Atlantic Ocean Current, the Great Conveyor Belt. This giant river of water is flowing from the Pacific. It's 100 times larger than all the rivers on Earth. And it's flowing from the Pacific, warm water at the surface of the sea. It's flowing around the southern tip of Africa, up along the coast of South America, around the southern tip of the United States, we call it the Gulf Stream, and up to Greenland. And then, because it's lost so much of its fresh water by evaporation, and it's lost so much of its temperature, it becomes colder, it settles to the bottom of the ocean. And then travels south, back the same route, all the way around Africa, and 1,000 years later appears out in the Pacific where it comes back up and the cycle repeats itself. That, of course, is what allows Europe to be temperate, even though Europe is at the same latitude as Siberia or Alaska. The temperature of the ocean just goes up a few degrees. Isn't that a great thing? No, it's not a great thing, because what it can do is it can shut down the Great Conveyor Belt and plunge the Northern Hemisphere into an ice age. That would mean unimaginable destruction of human life and human society, human culture.
There's one scenario which the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change has talked about, which they brought up about 12 years ago, I think, in deliberations. At the time, everyone thought it was so dramatic that it was nonsense. And that was the ability of global warming to actually shut down the ocean conveyor belt. It was thought to be so dramatic as to be impossible. But actually, what we're seeing now in the last few years is evidence that it's already happening.
The discovery and the use of fossil fuel is really the single most important technological advance in the entire history of humankind in terms of allowing us to dominate the planet and literally to displace other species from their sources of energy, to take over ecosystems, and to continue to divert the flows of natural energy into our own purposes and to aggrandize the human species. We're extinguishing other life forms somewhere between 100 and 10,000 times more rapidly than species were going extinct particularly prior to the Industrial Revolution. Now, some scientists have equated the current human impact on non-human life to other great extinctions historically that have occurred because of asteroid impacts or other cataclysmic events. Some say then we're in the sixth great extinction And this is a human-induced extinction. It's the first time in the history of the planet where one species of organism has become the equivalent of major geological events in determining the evolution of the rest of the life forms on Earth. So there are three big mechanisms. We take over habitats, we knock off the competition, and then we overconsume. And all of these things are accelerating the rates at which human beings are competitively displacing other species from the planet. And someday we may well rue the consequences of this.
We become so numerous and so powerful that we're threatening the existence of all other life forms. We desperately need to evolve a sustainable way of life that's not based on fossil fuels.
The United States in the 1950s was the world's largest producer of petroleum. The United States in the 1950s had the world's largest known reserves of petroleum. And the United States was on a rise. We had seen about 60 or 70 years of continuous exponential growth in the amount of oil being extracted in the United States. But in 1956, King Hubbert, then a petroleum geologist with Shell Oil, predicted that the United States would peak in its oil production by 1970. Well, that was only 15 years away. So we'd seen almost three quarters of a century of continuous increase in oil production. The country was on an exponential roll. How could anyone imagine this could all come to a glittering end in just 15 years? And so this prediction was vilified.
I went to the Shell Research Lab and there met M. King Hubbert, who had just predicted that the U.S. oil production would peak in the early 1970s. Hubbert printed this prediction and gave it orally as a talk, and he claimed later that down to 15 minutes before he went on the platform, the head office of Shell Oil was still on the phone saying, "Don't do it, don't do it." Well, he did it, and for a while, of course, we didn't know it was coming true. And in 1970, when it did happen, we still didn't know. You kind of see that in the rearview mirror. But what we did learn in 1972 was that the Texas Railroad Commission announced production rationing is off in Texas. Well, that meant, the United States has no unused production capacity, and then we were dependent on exports. And I came home that evening and told my family, old Hubbert was right. We're in the soup now.
As it turns out, he was dead on. U.S. oil production peaked in 1970 or 71, and it's been downhill ever since.
Oil discoveries in the U.S. had peaked in the 1930s. As discoveries were constantly diminishing, M. King Hubbert realized that eventually production would diminish as well. It was only a matter of time. Worldwide oil discoveries have followed a pattern similar to discovery rates in the United States.
World oil discoveries peaked in 1963, and this is not a particularly controversial fact, although it's not widely discussed. Actual discoveries have been declining dramatically for the past 40 years. Currently, the world uses about 84 million barrels of oil per day. So that's the world oil production capacity. Because a number of countries are past their all-time oil production peaks, that means that their oil production is constantly diminishing.
Of the top 30 oil-producing countries in the world, which represent roughly 90% of the world's oil production, at least 15 have passed peak oil and therefore produce less oil each successive year. The United States passed peak production in the early 1970s. Today, the U.S. produces less than two-thirds of the daily volume it produced at its peak. Iran produces roughly one-third less than it did in its peak year of 1974. Kuwait produces roughly 30% less than its peak year of 1972. And Libya produces less than half of its peak year of 1970. Russia, Oman, Venezuela, Norway, and seven others have also passed their production peak.
Between 2005 and 2010, we'll need about another 30 million barrels a day of new production capacity just to offset depletion. There's about 12.5 million barrels a day of new production capacity headed our way over the next 5 years. Now, clearly that's not going to be enough to make up for the 30 million barrels a day needed just to offset depletion. Nor the extra maybe 8 to 10 million barrels a day needed in order to meet growing demand. So we're going to hit a patch probably around 2007, where supply is simply no longer going to be sufficient to meet demand. And that will probably coincide very closely with the world oil production peak.
We've been following the peak oil debate very closely, and our group of geologists is very much involved. And our view is that it's not a resource problem, it's an investment problem.
I have a long-running battle with economists. They think if you show up the cashier's cage with a big stack of currency, God will put some more oil in the ground.
The United States Geological Survey, called the USGS, estimates oil reserves for the United States and worldwide. It is on the data compiled by the USGS and analyzed by the Energy Information Administration that the U.S. government sets its energy policy around oil. One of the likely reasons the U.S. government has not taken steps to mitigate peak oil's impact is that the USGS believes that there is substantially more oil than others have estimated.
We work very closely with the United States Geological Survey, the USGS, and we think their methodology for assessing world resources is a reasonable one, and we rely on that for our modeling.
Channel 4 News has been told by a top Saudi oil industry insider that the American government's forecast for future oil supplies is a dangerous overestimate.
In a rare interview, the man that's just retired as head of exploration at Aramco, that's the Saudi state oil giant, he's told us that the estimates from the U.S. government energy think tank, that's the EIA, they're simply too high. Here he is.
They're not only overestimating the Middle East, but they overestimate non-OPEC, they overestimate Russia, they overestimate the whole global resource base. And I think this is a rather dangerous situation for the U.S. government policy to be based on.
I've been teasing the U.S. Geological Survey. They also had a very high estimate for the United States. And I says, where is the rest of that stuff? Is it under South Alabama? Just whisper in my ear. We'll all get fabulously rich. An email has leaked out from the director of the U.S. Geological Survey to the teams making the estimates saying, it's important that we have big estimates because that'll encourage people to go out and find more oil. There's very little time to do anything, and we haven't been doing anything, and we're not now doing anything, and our political leaders either don't know or don't care that there's a problem.
Back in the late 1980s, OPEC made a rule change which said that member countries could extract and export oil proportionally to their stated reserves. Now, this instantly provided an incentive to member countries to overstate their reserves because they wanted to extract and export as much oil as they could in order to earn foreign exchange income. So within a couple of years of this rule change, every OPEC country stated reserve increases of between 50 and 200%, even when there were no important new discoveries being made. Saudi Arabia in 1 year went from having something like 140 billion barrels of reported reserves to something like 250 billion barrels. We could go down the list. Every OPEC country did essentially the same thing. Now, a lot of people assume when they read in the New York Times or Newsweek magazine or someplace that Saudi Arabia has 256 billion barrels of proven reserves, that this is a figure that's somehow monitored by some independent international agency. Maybe there's a global oil cop with a big dipstick that goes around and checks once a year just to see, you know, how much is in the tank. That's far from being the case for countries like Saudi Arabia and Kuwait. True national oil reserves are a state secret. All we have to go on is their word for it. And the evidence is that, in fact, these countries actually have much less oil than they're reporting.
We are moving from cheap, abundant oil to expensive, scarce oil. And we absolutely are, with technology, without technology, where the peak is, where the peak is not. And that change is a major change in the industrial history of the world. And that change is going to be huge.
Frankly, I think the greatest danger arising from peak oil is the likelihood of resource wars.
Is there a possibility of conflict? Absolutely. Is it possible that in an oil exporting region, the United States would end up aiding one force and the Chinese another because there's oil there? Absolutely, an absolute possibility in the future. I think the danger is not only between large powers that are consumers of oil. I think the danger is that there will be more invasions to secure oil. There will be more threats against oil exporters that if they don't behave in a certain way, they may face a military action. And I also think that there is an increasing, huge danger of civil conflict and civil war inside oil exporters themselves.
The biggest worry is that the whole world economy will go into a nosedive. And that's a very serious proposition. As the increase in petroleum supplies comes to an end and we have a stagnant production curve and demand is rising, the world economy will have very little flexibility in it to respond to crises.
It's very difficult to overemphasize how fragile the supply-demand balance is. Any relatively small interruption in supplies, whether it be politically motivated or industrial accidents, can lead to large spikes in oil prices.
I think a prolonged global recession with high prices and a lot of insecurity is going to lead to political instability as well as economic instability. Regimes will fall, crises will erupt, and how that will play itself out, nobody can be sure, but I'm certain that it'll be a very scary, tense period.
As oil becomes more valuable and scarce, I think it's overwhelmingly likely that the oil companies will look for it absolutely anywhere that it can possibly be found. Offshore from California and Florida, in Alaska and the National Wildlife Refuge. And South America, I don't think any place is really off limits, ultimately.
It means eating up pristine areas. It means
killing environments. It means moving indigenous peoples. It means destroying the air. It means destroying the water in an earth that is increasingly smaller and smaller and not able to handle this.
Let's suppose that tomorrow somebody discovered a limitless free source of energy that could completely replace fossil fuels. Would that solve our problem? Well, frankly, I don't think so. For us, right now, it may seem like fossil fuels is the limiting factor for continued industrial growth. But if we solve that problem and continue growing our economy, growing our extraction and use of other resources, we'll just hit upon another one, and probably very soon. I would guess within a matter of years or a decade or two, we'll hit the next wall, whether it's fresh water or topsoil or minerals, phosphates, and so on. It's okay to imagine that, you know, we can, as we get to each one, we can make up for it. You know, the human mind is so, clever that with each one we would be able to find some substitute and just keep growing exponentially forever to the point where I suppose we would have a human population such that there'd be 50 of us standing on every square foot of space on planet Earth. That's not going to happen. There are natural limits.
Fossil fuel has been the basis of the explosive expansion of the human enterprise, not only population numbers, but all of the material assets that we've accumulated in the course of the Industrial Revolution. And this train is gathering steam. As long as energy continues to be available in excess of the ultimate demand, then the engine just keeps rolling on, and more people are jumping on the bandwagon. So what we're seeing here is one species among millions on a finite planet having found the key, the evolutionary key, to continuous expansion as long as that energy holds out. But the problem is, we're using the energy in ways that are undermining everything else. So if we find an equivalent to fossil fuel, if some substitute comes along, if technology is indeed as successful as economists suggest that it may well be, and there's no corresponding change in the values and beliefs and assumptions behind the growth dynamic, then the planet is doomed.
I actually think by the time I finish that maybe I'm hallucinating, but that there is actually an optimistic life after peak oil if everybody quickly understands how unbelievably serious this is and starts behaving in some radically different manners.
Given the situation in which we currently find ourselves, perhaps the four most powerful steps we can take are bringing population into balance with the Earth and other life forms, reducing our energy consumption, supporting local organic foods that use little or no fossil fuels, and making our voices heard to awaken our politicians to these issues.
Population is a very real issue, and it's the interconnection of population growth and fossil fuel consumption or resource energy consumption that we must be addressing. So many people are only looking at the fossil fuel part of it. Turns out when you look carefully at it, you find that the one variable that determines whether population explodes or not is the power of women in a culture. In the Middle East, for example, Saudi Arabia, population explosion going on. It's creating a real crisis for the Saudi society. On the other hand, there are countries, more secular nations in the Middle East, that are equally Muslim, but women have relatively equal power in some of those societies. Iran, for example, you're at nearly zero population growth in Iran right now, compared to Saudi Arabia.
If you made sure that there was justice and economic opportunity for people in the poorest countries, people would choose to have fewer children there. And if people were consuming less here and were sharing more of what they had with the rest of the world, you actually do begin to get the outcomes that both address concerns around population as well as environmental sustainability.
One area where I think environmentalists have gone wrong is to try to sell sustainability in terms of the kinds of sacrifices people have to make. They're going to have to give this up and give that up. Nothing sells if people feel they're going to be worse off as a result of doing this. Using off-the-shelf technologies, people could continue to have the equivalent lifestyle in terms of material well-being with one quarter the energy use.
I think people should take an immediate energy inventory of their lives and see how much energy they're actually using and how much energy they need to use. When my wife and I did this a few years ago, we were amazed to find that we could get by perfectly well on about one-fifth the amount of electricity that the average California household uses.
People think, oh, how could one person possibly make a difference? But in fact, there have been studies that have shown that if everybody in the United States switched one of their lights to fluorescent lights, we would significantly cut down on our energy consumption. So there are choices that individuals can make that will make a difference collectively if enough individuals make those choices.
We do have to make a massive shift in our way of thinking, a paradigmatic change in the beliefs, values, and assumptions underpinning agricultural production. Something like 17%, perhaps a little more now, of the U.S. energy budget is involved in food production, processing, and distribution.
We need to nurture our local economies. With food, this is perhaps most important of all. We need to get to know our local farmers. And a great way of doing that is through what's called community-supported agriculture, where you actually make an agreement with a specific local farmer to supply you with food. And so what this does is it relocalizes the economy and it makes our food system not only more sustainable, but much more resilient. And that's tremendously important.
The single most important thing we need to do is to become politically engaged to convince our politicians that we have to constrain our consumption through regulatory regimes and legal frameworks that impose upon all nations equally strictures against the inappropriate use of resources, against, for example, simple things such as subsidizing the oil and gas sector.
Unless the general public that is being disadvantaged by these policies is in there fighting for change, the special interests are going to win out every time. So I think one has to be involved politically with the society in making the needed changes.
It sounds often like the scale of the problems is so huge. And I think what I love is that the level at which you can intervene really is one village, one community, one home, one family at a time. It makes a difference.
Our society is almost unrecognizable in almost every dimension from what it was like 100 years ago. If we can make those changes over the last 100 years, why can't we make similar changes in the next 100, but in a very different direction, in the direction of a more sustainable world?
We have got to convince people that given current trends, we're headed for disaster. That's the bad news. This new knowledge gives us the possibility of acting in ways that create a brilliant future for all of us. So we need, as environmentalists, as good economists, as just concerned citizens, to begin to discern that a brighter future comes from making change.
What one person can do, what you can do, what each one of us must do if we're going to have a decent world, a good world in which to live, and certainly if we're going to leave a healthy planet to our children and grandchildren, what we must do is personally wake up to these issues and then be an instrument of awakening, if only for one other person. Tag, you're it.
Thank you. say that everybody can be somebody, and everybody is free to make a difference.
Everybody can be somebody,
and everybody is free to make a difference.
You don't have to be
a big celebrity.
You don't have to be
to feel the power in your soul. No, no, you don't have to be a big star on MTV to realize that in your eyes is a view that only you can see.